had a lot of like young couples come in and they would have sex when the girl still had her tampon in. I'm like, did you forget or did you like it in there?
No, I think a lot of women forget the tampon. Sometimes they go up so far, like especially those little OB ones. There's been a lot of those tales, but like, what other things are they forgetting up there?
I mean, one lady had like a phone charger in there for some reason.
Phone charger in her vagina.
But she was also not really there.
Do you ever have surprise pregnancies come in? Where they had no idea? They're like, oh.
More common than the butt thing.
Really?
Young girls, not even young girls, like they just come in. They're like, I have a stomach ache. I don't know what's going on. And our very first question for a girl with abdominal pain, any chance you could be pregnant? And they will always be like, no. All right, if you're sure, let's just get a pregnancy test anyways. It always comes back positive.
And how far along are we talking with these then?
It could be, I've seen as far as like 6 months.
What?
Yeah.
What's the last weird thing somebody had stuck inside them?
Hilarious comedian, ex-EMT.
That's right.
Worker. Is that how you say it? Stephen Ho, how are you?
I'm good. How are you?
Good. Thank you for being here.
Yes.
I love meeting people that I've seen on the internet and then I see in real life and then we become friends. I'm forcing a friendship on you right now. You're like, no. But then we become friends.
I'm here against my will right now.
There are chains under the table. I have dragged him here.
Call somebody.
Please, please help. Because I saw you all over TikTok when I was really using it. And then I saw you at the Laugh Factory.
Yeah. We did a show at Laugh Factory. I think I was hosting. I'm doing it again this Tuesday, 10 p.m., hosting the Tuesday show.
Yes. Uh-huh. Well, you weren't there the night that I met my new boyfriend. Maybe you were.
No. Okay. I don't know if you were with him at the time. You had a bit about Hinge and a dead dog.
Oh, yeah. That bit's still going strong. That bit's still going strong. Don't kill your dog and talk about it on Hinge. Just a fun FYI, people. But yeah, did you start stand-up or did you start like... How did this happen?
So I was working in the ER for 10 years, and during COVID, I took a stand-up class.
Okay.
In 2019. But even before that, I was doing a lot of like theater, so I was used I've been on stage.
Yeah.
But I really wanted to do stand-up comedy. Took a class in 2019, and then COVID hit, everything shut down, and then started doing like these TikTok videos.
Yes.
In COVID, things blew up. Mm-hmm. And then COVID was over, so we got back on stage and, went from selling like zero tickets to, you know.
Lots of tickets.
Yeah. And like my first show after COVID was like in this tiny little black box 20-seater. And there was like a line out the door. I'm like, oh, we can't keep doing this.
No, we can't keep doing this.
Yeah.
Because I had thought after seeing, like when I saw your stuff on TikTok, that you had been doing comedy way before that. Because you have like a cadence about it. Like you have like a joke format. You're not just like, there's one TikToker that I don't want to say his name, but I fucking hate him so badly. He's so unfunny. He's like an open mic comedian who went viral, who like you probably know, he's probably a good fucking friend of yours, and like I find him horrendous, and I tried watching his clips to be like, maybe I'm the problem, and then I'm like, no, you're just not funny at all, but you actually are funny.
Thank you.
Trying to be nice right now, and it's coming across meanly because I started with a mean thing.
She's very aggressive.
It came across mean at the beginning, but because I remember seeing your TikToks and I would like actually watch them.
Yeah.
And I didn't do that a lot with people. I would like scroll through, but I was like, because I have this gross podcast of body stuff, it was like, I think I was on like the ER TikTok already.
Oh, yeah.
So that was coming up a lot.
No, it helped that I did a lot of theater. Cause like, I was also writing. So like, you know, I was doing like monologues. So like I made sure there was jokes in the monologue, you know, made sure it was funny, made sure it was interesting. I tried to, at least I think it worked.
Yeah. And also like you're telling, like it's a nice thing on TikTok, especially because it's different. You're not talking about the same fucking thing. You're not just doing a front-facing video where you're like saying nothing, which is what I feel like they like.
That's definitely the trend these days on TikTok. Like it's all about, and here's what it's all about: facing the camera and just talking about like your problem or your day to day. And I think why that's happening now is because there's so few like actual live interactions with people these days that when you open, you're at home, you don't want to go out, you open your phone, you kind of just want to have someone talk to you like a friend, in the living room. And so it's becoming very popular where people are just waking up in their pajamas, doing their makeup, just be like, so I went on this date yesterday and oh my God, you would not believe what happened.
It's
and
crazy.
Those kill.
Yeah, because I was posting some stand-up stuff recently and I don't know if I'm shadow banned, but yikes, I've deleted about 5 clips in the last week. Holy hell. I got like 400 views. I'm like, I have a lot of followers. I shouldn't be getting 400 fucking views. You don't get shadow banned, do you, a lot?
You know what? I don't know. I don't know. I used to get banned a lot because of my videos.
Really? Because of the topics?
Because of the topics, because, you know, people are get upset, you know, when you talk about patients and pain and you make fun of, you know, if it sounds like you're making fun of people who are like, you know, who have diseases, right?
Yeah.
But I thought I did it in a tasteful way, but some people still get upset. And so I've been banned a few times because of those videos.
Oh, really? Oh, yeah. That's so annoying. It's also like, then I'll watch a video with literally a girl like pouring cold cups of water on her white t-shirt and her full jugs jumping up and down. I'm like, that's allowed on TikTok?
I've seen nipples on TikTok.
Full nips.
I don't know what is happening out there.
And I'm out here with a full mustache and people are like, we hate this. This is bad. I had actually a very interesting interaction last week. My dog, I was walking my dog, East Hollywood, cool area. And this other dog was loose and I was like, what the fuck? So like, my dog's very good. So I took my dog off the leash and I hooked this other dog on. And I'm like, I see there's a number on the collar. So I'm calling the number. I'm like, hello. I'm like, I have your dog here. And then this man starts walking towards me with no arms. And I'm like, I'm on the phone. I'm like, there's a guy coming towards me who says, he's like, oh, that's my dog. That's Onyx. It's my dog. And I was like, oh, there's a guy that says it's his dog. And the woman on the phone's like, well, what does he look like? And I'm like, he's got two legs. Like, what am I supposed to fucking say to this guy? I'm like, he's a guy with two working legs and a full face. And then he's like, it's my dog. I'm like, okay. So like, I took the dog off and then I couldn't give him to him because he had no arms. So he was like,
wrap the leash around his neck.
Here you go. Get out of here. So he just kind of like went, and then he like was like ushering the dog with his feet across the street. It was a whole ordeal. And I'm not making my people with no arms. On red. Steph Tolev hates people with no arms.
I just like, fuck amputees.
That's what I'm trying to say. No, I was everyone stops watching right now. I was just like, it was a very bizarre situation. I'm like, how do you explain? Anyways, it was fine. I've just never seen no arms. Like, not
why,
even like
why would she? Why would she ask that question though?
I don't know. Like, what he look like? I guess because anyone could have just yelled, "That's my dog." Uh-huh. But he was saying the dog's name, so I assume. Yeah. It was a lot, and I was trying not to be rude to look at the no arms. So I was like staring him dead in the eyes. I was like, "Okay, here's your dog, sir." And I was like, "So I'm like, he has the dog now, kind of like he was just like kicking it across the street." The poor thing probably ran away because he's not getting pet a lot.
That's true. Oh my god, that's fucking funny.
If I do this on stage, I will be canceled immediately. Do you love touring? You love stand up? You got a huge tour coming up.
Yeah, I have a huge, big tour coming up. I love it. I really do. And we were talking earlier about, like, you know, I used to be doing like these one nighters. Mm-hmm. You know, they invite you in for one night. So I guess what comedy clubs do is like, because like they don't really trust you yet, right?
Yes, so especially if it's like the TikTok background kind of thing.
Especially if it's a TikTok background, they know you could sell tickets. So here, do like a Wednesday.
Yes.
Come sell it out for us. Do us a favor. We're not even open Wednesdays.
Sell
it out. And let's just see if you're funny.
But that means you're funny because it's bringing you back. Because this one person that I'm talking about, that I'll tell you off camera. Well, it's me, Stephanie Lynn Tolev. Here are my tour dates. Please come to shows. It really helps me out. Also, share my stuff. Follow me on Instagram. The whole fucking shit. Anyways, here's where I'm going to be in the next few months. Appleton, Wisconsin. I love Wisconsin. I'm a pile of cheese. Come see me there March 21st to 23rd. Then I'll be in Ohio. Excusez-moi, never been there before. I'll be in the Cincinnati Funny Bone April 5th and 6th. And then I'll be in Columbus, Ohio at the Funny Bone on the 7th of April. Then I will be in, where the hell is this? Magoobie's Joke House, Baltimore. Fucking Baltimore. Thanks, Aaron. I'll be in Baltimore April 18th to 20th. Then I'll be doing one nighter, one show. Help me sell this out so I can do two in Philadelphia at the Punchline on April 21st. Then guess what? Here's my big announcement, big drop. I am coming to New York City to do a one-off Filth show, my new dirty show presented by the Comedy Store. Dirty, filthy, all crowd work, comics doing stories, not a normal show, not the same set you've seen me do for the last year and a half. So come see that. I'll be at LPR, Le Poisson Rouge, right across from the Cellar. Come see me on April 24th. That's where I'll be there. And then that's it for now. Go follow Steph Infection on Instagram. Follow me on Instagram if you're not. And go buy tickets. PunchUp.live/Steph Tolev. Is so bad and bombs so bad that people leave going, oh, that's what we came to see. Like, we thought this was a fucking comedian and this is some weird fucking thing we're watching. So that means that you actually are
Yeah.
A funny man.
No.
So you can do jokes and have people that want to come back and see you again.
I fucking hope so. No, So next year, like you said, next year, now that we're doing weekends, they're inviting you back. It's like, oh, you can sell tickets and you're decently funny. We'll give you a shot.
Yeah.
Here's five shows.
Yeah. And then you'll get to the fifth show and be like, I'm dead. You're new. I'm like, I'm 20 years in.
No. But I get it. I get it. Because like I've been on the road with Jack Jr. He's another comedian. I'll feature for him for like six shows, right? He does a weekend. Mm-hmm. And like, I totally get it. Even by the second day of the second show, like, I am just pissed drunk. I'm like, I can't take this anymore.
Yeah. No, it's...
Give me a drink.
I was trying to do Dry January and I'm going to Pittsburgh this weekend and I'm like, that's not gonna happen. Pittsburgh sober? Are you kidding me? There's a fucking Bills game happening. It's a whole thing.
The
playoff game, and I'm in the Steelers, and my boyfriend likes the Bills. So now I like the Bills. I don't know what's going on. I'm like, look at dude, that guy's ass. That's me watching football. I don't know what the fuck's going on. I'm an idiot.
I love football.
I'm trying to learn. Do you? Are you a football guy?
I love football.
Really? What's your team?
49ers.
Really? Okay. Oh, yeah. Are you from San Fran?
Mm-hmm. From the Bay Area.
Okay. Yeah,
I'm pretty strict on Sundays. I'm not doing much on Sundays.
No shows on Sundays.
Sitting on my couch. Yeah. You'll see it. Like my tour, Thursday through Saturday. There's nothing's happening Sunday.
I like that you do that though, because I think Sunday shows are the worst.
Yeah.
I try to like change it now to not do Sunday shows because I'm like, I don't want to be there. Thursday are usually my crowd. They're like fun, in the mood.
Yeah. Yeah, it's like the thing you talked about earlier, right? I don't really want to do six shows.
No, it's exhausting.
Yeah.
It's people don't realize, it's the getting there, the travel. And I was sick as hell last weekend. I'm like, I shouldn't be traveling when I'm sick, should I?
No.
Everybody's
sick.
Okay, let me ask this so you would know this. Isn't there a period where you're no longer contagious? I thought it was like the first 3 days you're fine. Again, I'm not a doctor, so I shouldn't be diagnosing myself.
I have no idea.
Okay.
Just if you're sick, stay the fuck at home.
Okay, well then I fucked up and I probably got several people sick this weekend. And I'm sorry. Totally and the man that called me dirty little slut in the meet greet line, I hope I got you sick because that was psychotic.
A random fan called you a dirty little slut.
Yeah, a random fan grabbed me on my shoulders and looked me in the eyes and said, "You're a dirty little slut." And I went, "What?" And then he said it again, like I didn't hear him the first time. And then him and his wife held me really tight in the photo. And then he like was staring at me the whole time. It was so creepy. And then, another woman said that, "I thought you were ugly. You're actually attractive in person." And I was like, I'm done.
People just don't know how to, like, they don't know how to compliment.
Also, I just think fans get weird.
Yeah.
In the meet and greet line, they're like, it's my chance. And then they're like, you're ugly. And I'm like, what the fuck is happening? Just say something normal. Because you're saying that people have been trying to you in there and did a little action.
Yeah, no, fans can get a little much. And I don't like, make you pay for a meet and greet.
No,
you
know,
like for pictures. Like, I'll go out there. I'll say like, I'll wait like 10 minutes. Hopefully some people leave, but like, I don't mind. I'll come out there. I'll take pictures. I'll say hi. Mm. But you know, at that point in the night, fans are a little drunk.
Yeah.
So they're really aggressive. Yeah.
You've been at your ass grabbed?
Yeah.
Man, all the time. All the time?
Because my fans are a lot of like middle-aged white women.
Okay.
And they see me, they're just like, oh my god, you're so cute. And they just start like, they act like I'm so small. They're just like, I just want to pick you up, put you in my pocket. So like I get grabbed a lot.
I feel like we're the same fans.
Yeah.
I also feel a lot of middle-aged women, a lot of middle-aged single women, which I love. Yes, it's relatable.
Same. We should go on tour.
We should go on tour. The relatable tour. People would be like, what a weird mix of people. Let's get into the ER stuff because I want to get in because I don't have a lot of ER people on the show and we love talking about issues and stuff. So you worked in the ER for 10 years.
I was in the ER for 10 years. I worked 2 years on the ambulance as an EMT. And then I worked 6 years at Stanford and then another 4 years, 2 years at a hospital in LA.
Oh my God. So you saw it all.
Saw
you
lot.
Saw the gambit. You saw the fucking beginning to the end. So what did we, let's get into this. So what are some highlights of some things that stood out to you where you're like, they had nightmares afterwards?
Oh my God. Nightmares?
Or are you just so numb to it now?
I'm pretty numb to it. But I think a lot about 4th of July. Because 4th of July in the ER is always just...
The worst?
It's the worst because someone always gets their hand blown up.
From the fireworks.
From the fireworks. There's always a hand that is just blown up to bits and pieces every single year.
So you come in with that, and do you bring the bits with you to put back in, or the bits are gone?
If you found them, if they're still there, if they're still intact. But for the most part, it's like there's nothing left.
Just no hand. No, nothing at all. Like, what are we talking about? Coming in with what?
Sometimes there's a nub. Sometimes it's like half the hand's here, half the hand's there. So it's just like hanging.
Like the bottom's hanging off?
The bottom's hanging off.
Like a crocodile?
Like a crocodile.
Oh my God.
Like a swamp monster.
Oh my God.
You'll see everything. Sometimes half the hand's gone. They've got like the two fingers left and maybe like just the bone sticking out. It's all kinds of stuff. People are just crazy because they're drunk.
Yeah.
You know? They're holding firecrackers or fireworks. They get a little too close to things. Like, people are just reckless on 4th of July.
Listen up, folks. Don't fucking be lighting fireworks. This is crazy. When someone comes in when their hand is completely torn to shreds and you know that's not going to be, like, they must know. Are they like, can you fix it? Are you like, well, this is, you're screwed.
They're just in shock. I don't think they know what's going to happen. But by the time they get there, like, as soon as they get there, we try to pump them with a bunch of painkillers so they don't feel anything and they get woozy. A surgeon will come down, evaluate. If he thinks he can fix it, they'll bring him up to surgery. If not, like, they'll wrap up the freaking nub and
that's it. And that's you it. Go home.
Yeah.
Wrap the nub and leave.
Wrap the nub and get the fuck out.
What
some antibiotics and get out of there.
And do the people leave in tears or are they still kind of in shock to know what's happening? Like, I feel like if I left, you'd be like, your hand's done. I'd be like, I'm not leaving until I have a hand. Like, I'd be demanding a hand. I'd be demanding a hand. I'm like, give
me
a hand.
Your hand.
I want a hand. I'm not leaving this hospital unless I have a hand. So you've never, like, seen... The ambulance must have been a lot of, like, car accidents. Like, what happened?
So when I was working in the ambulance, I actually didn't do the 911 calls. So there's different levels in EMT. There's, like, when I was working, I started off, I did, like, just inter-facility transports, which means just taking patients either from the hospital to go home or from their home to go, like, dialysis. It was very low-key.
Okay.
So you're
not doing anything crazy.
That wasn't much. Yeah, okay. I think I got like an emergency call once, and it was just like a false alarm.
Okay, that must be like terrifying. Did you get to like put the sirens on and drive like a crazy person though?
I've only ever done that once seriously, but many times for fun.
Really? You just doing? No one's gonna stop you.
No, I mean it's. You shouldn't do it, but
no. No one's telling you to do it,
but when I did it, like, it wasn't like a hazard to the road. It was like 3 a.m. at night, and we were like in an area where like nothing was going on. We were just like, let's turn on for fun.
I feel like anyone listening who had the opportunity to turn a siren on and drive like a maniac would do it.
Oh, yeah.
No sane person would be like, no, thank you. I don't want to do this.
Also, it was for training purposes. I had to know
it's
what it felt like.
For training purposes.
I had to know what it feels like, you know, in case there was an emergency and I had to do it.
And this is why you were good at your job, because you're good. You got the training you needed.
Very good. Yes.
Okay. So back. So let's get back into the. I want all the juice here.
So there was one incident. Like this is a sad incident on 4th of July.
Yeah. Okay.
If you want to hear this,
I do want to hear it.
There was a family of four: mom, dad, and their two sons. I think one brother was 12 or 14. The other one may have been like 8 or 7 years old. And they came in because the older brother had picked up a stray firecracker from the beach and it blew up in his fucking hand.
No,
it was the saddest thing. And they were sitting in the room, and I walked past them, and the parents are sad, right? Kid's never playing football again. He's never thrown a ball again. And the little brother was also very sad, but it was the big brother who had his hand blown up that was consoling the little brother.
No.
Like, it's going to be okay. We'll still play. It'll still be like normal.
Oh my God.
It was the saddest thing. And it was, you know, and it's just, it's fucked up because someone left that stray firecracker at the beach and this poor kid picked it up and it blew up in his hand.
Because it was still like lit and he didn't realize?
I don't know what happened, how it happened, but he picked it up and it blew up, and that's kind of all we knew.
We need to stop with the fireworks. I feel like this might be the PSA for this specific episode.
Yeah. Or, you know, have it in a controlled environment where professionals are dealing with it.
Yeah. There's a guy named Ed Stinson at my cottage. He does the fireworks out on a dock in the middle of the lake, and we all watch from a far distance, and he knows what he's doing. Thanks, Ed. Thanks, Ed, for being safe.
Go, Ed.
Ed's great. He's got his full eyebrows, never burnt them off. He's doing well out there.
Fucking love you, Ed.
we love Ed.
Keep doing you.
Yeah, because I've held a sparkler once. I've never like had the urge to do that.
Yeah, same. Even with a sparkler, I'm like, ugh, get as far as possible.
So wait, when you were in like training and stuff, you wanted to get into like, why did you get into this to begin with? Did you want
the EMT stuff?
Yeah.
Oh, fuck my Asian parents. That's what it was.
I don't want to assume, but for the listeners, I don't want to assume, but
I get Asian parents. Steph,
were they in it?
No.
No, okay.
No, of course not.
Like passed down? Okay. Like,
yeah, no, they're never. They're like, they were immigrants. They were restaurant owners.
Okay.
It was just like, you know, you got to go to college. You got to do something. Like, I guess I'll be a doctor.
I
was like,
I love that that's so casual. I guess. If I said, I guess my doctor, my parents would be like, you're an idiot. So let's think of something else. Yeah, clowning. Let's get you into clowning. So you went, okay, so you took a lot of years.
I took a lot of the medical classes in college, the science classes, got my EMT right out of college and started working on the ambulance, and was trying to go to medical school. So I was applying to medical school. It didn't work out, obviously. Uh-huh. And then somewhere along the lines, I took like a theater class at a community college, and it just fucking snowballed.
Okay.
And I fell in love with theater, did it for 6 years while working as an EMT.
How much did your parents hate this?
Oh, come on.
Were they so mad?
They were like, so pissed.
I want to do Shakespeare. They're like, get in there with the knife, cut them open.
They were so pissed. But I just kept telling them, oh, no, I'm still going to school. I'm still trying to raise my grades. I'm like taking all these classes. I'm applying to programs. Because I kept doing both.
Okay.
I kept working. I kept taking classes and I kept doing theater. So I was like, you know, my life was crazy. But like, as long as I kept them happy,
yeah.
I knew I could do what I wanted. I didn't live with them, but like I still felt so guilty.
Oh God.
I still felt so guilty.
What a nice boy.
Yeah.
My parents were like, you might be a comedian. That's stupid. And I was like, suck my ass.
Yeah, no. Couldn't do
That's why my parents don't respect me though. And they probably respect you. Okay, so when you first started taking like the courses and stuff, none of that grossed you out? You never had like a weak stomach to like blood and stuff?
The EMT stuff? No.
Yeah.
No, I started really young as a volunteer in the ER. I think I was like 19 or 20 years old. I started as a Vietnamese medical translator. That's how I got in. Because where I worked, the community in San Jose in the Bay Area had a big Vietnamese population.
Okay.
And I spoke Vietnamese.
So you went in there and you were like doing a little...
Yeah, I went in there and I was just a fly on the wall until they needed a translator.
Really?
So I saw everything. Yeah.
And that never grossed you out? You were in there just poking around?
No, dude, it was so interesting. It was so interesting.
So you like... Because the IV thing grosses me out. Like, you can put that in, no problem.
I do not put in IVs.
No, you never? Okay,
no,
you never,
I don't do anything invasive.
Okay, okay. You don't. So what's the most invasive thing you've done to someone then?
I will do vitals. I will help triage. I will determine if you're big, sick, or little sick.
Big, sick, little sick. What is that? You're saying terms?
Like if I see someone come in and if I see like, okay, this person is clearly in trouble. Let's get you back there. Let's get somebody on you. And if you're not clearly in trouble, okay, like just wait in the waiting room.
They're called big, sick, and little sick?
Yeah.
Oh, that's kind of cute.
It's triaging, yeah.
Oh, that's cute.
Yeah.
So what's big, sick? Is like you're severely bleeding.
Big, sick, you're severely bleeding. You got, you know, something impaled into your body, or, you know, you're clearly having a heart attack. You're sweating profusely. You're short of breath.
Okay, okay.
Something's going on internally that we can't see.
Okay. But otherwise, you come in with like a little like a sprained ankle. You're sitting for a while. Sprained ankles—they really make you fucking sit there.
Sprained, yeah, no, because you're gonna be fine. You can sit with a sprained ankle for an entire day.
And guess what? I have, because they make you fucking sit there for 9 hours when you fucking sprain your ankle. Don't go to the hospital if you sprain your ankle.
Yeah.
Do you have people that come in that are like liars? Have you ever seen like people come in like
all the time
that are just like, I'm hurt, and they're just what's that called when you're like a hypochondriac? I guess.
I have no idea what it's called, but all the time people come, and they lie for all sorts of reasons, right? They lie because, you know, they want pain meds, which is the biggest thing, right?
Yeah.
Pain is like 17 out of 10. I'm hurt. You know, I'm hurt. Oh, they're like, they're complaining. And, you know, but you walk away and you look back through the windows and through the curtains and they're just perfectly fine.
Uh-huh.
That happens a lot.
You got to really act then if you're going into these things.
Dude, oh my God. We had one guy who came in and he knew exactly how to act. It freaked everybody out. He came in and was like, and we're like, holy shit, this guy's having a heart attack. Call everybody. And we're like, getting things, we're doing an EKG, like it shows nothing. I'm like, it shows nothing. What do we do? It's like, he's short of breath. Get an IV in him, push some meds. Everybody was freaking the fuck out. And eventually, like, it calmed down. We're like, we don't really know what's going on. He's like sitting still. I swear to God, like an hour later, he gets discharged and I see him at the venue machines buying a Snickers. I'm like, this piece of shit.
Yeah, like, he's fine. But what if he was just hungry?
That's no way to act if you're hungry.
But Snickers, like the one thing you get when you're hungry?
Yeah.
It's like that's the one thing they tell you. If you're hungry, grab a Snickers.
If you're hungry, you're not you when you're hungry.
Exactly. You're see? The marketing is working for Snickers.
Oh, my God. I mean, we have people come in who just ask for a sandwich, right? It's like, hey, can I get some food? And like, you know, like.
Do you give it to them?
Sometimes.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Sometimes if, you know, you're nice and like. it's, you know, they ask for like, can I get a warm blanket? Is it cold outside? Yeah, I'll get you a warm blanket.
Oh, okay, that's nice. Yeah, okay, we, you know,
we try to be fucking humans once in a while, you know?
What's the like most alarming thing you've seen come in?
Most alarming thing I've
seen?
Like
something that we were like, this is different. Like a very strange ER entrance.
You know, there was a guy who came in an ambulance. It was a homeless dude who they found under an underpass of the freeway. I guess someone called and was like, hey, there's this homeless guy there. Like, I don't know what he's doing. I think he's in trouble. And the ambulance brought him in, and they put him on a bed in the hallway of the ambulance, of the ER. And like, I was the EMT, so like, I'm usually the first to say hi and figure out what's going on. Yeah. And so they drop him off, they go talk to the doctor. I get there and I talk to the homeless dude, and he's like, hey man, my name's Steven. I'm the, you know, the ER technician. I'm here to help you out. And the guy doesn't say anything. He's like deadpan staring, right? But he's got like a trash bag on his leg. So I assume that's what he's there for.
Okay.
So I was like, hey sir, I'm gonna take this trash bag off you and see what's going on, okay? And he doesn't say anything. I take that bag off and a pool of maggots just falls at my feet. All over my feet. And his entire calf is gone, and it's just flesh eating maggots. They're just like moving all over
it. Oh.
It was the first time. Yeah.
What? Okay,
it was the first time I had ever felt my stomach like flip, and I felt my whole body go white. Like I'd never seen anything like it.
Oh my. Wait, he's not reacting at all.
And he's not reacting at all. Isn't that crazy? He was just.
Oh, I don't know. That might be freakier than the fact that his leg was just maggots. Tied up. So he trapped it. Were they like moving up the leg? You must have had to amputate the whole leg.
No, they were just on the leg, like eating it. It wasn't moving. They were just right there where they were. But it was like they were crawling all over his leg, and it fell all over my feet.
Oh, God.
And I'd never felt anything like that before.
Maggots might be the grossest thing on the entire planet.
It is. And when to see just like a million of them on a human leg.
So they fall down, then do you have to clean them up?
I mean, we call housekeeping, but yeah, of course. Okay, like, I help. Yeah.
And then, so what happened to that guy then?
So that guy, you know.
That guy's not doing good.
He's not doing good.
That guy ain't doing well.
The leg is infected, which is why the maggots are there. They're eating the dead flesh. But what happens with this is that so the doctor will come down. They'll evaluate it. And we can't just wipe the maggots off because they're actually helping. So like
they are.
Yeah. So it turns out they're actually helping the legs. If you take the maggots off, I forget like what the science is, but there's a higher chance that the leg, something bad will happen to the leg. So what they had to do was leave the maggots there. Don't fuck with them in the ER. And as soon as they got him upstairs, like the OR or like wherever he's going, the doctors and the nurses will carefully take the maggots off and wrap it immediately. But you have to leave them there.
Oh.
So he was sitting there with the flesh-eating maggots in the ER in the hallway. And I'm just like, cover that shit up.
Oh, no, you had to cover it up. Put the garbage bag back on. Get a new garbage bag.
Get some curtains. Get them in the room.
Jeez, I might gag. You might have just topped the new air. What do you think? The grossest story we've heard on here? It's pretty close.
I've seen a lot. I've seen body parts hanging off people. I've seen brain matter. I've seen cracked skulls. That was by far
the worst.
The most nauseous I'd ever been.
The sound of maggots. I don't know if I've told this around here, but years ago I was cleaning under a foosball table when I lived in college with eight guys, and there's a plastic bag hanging on the foosball table, and I had my ear closer. I'm like, what the fuck is that? And I took all the coats off. I'm like, what is this bag? And I opened it up, and somebody had left a bag of hot dogs and hot dog buns, and it had just become maggots. Like it was like three quarters full of just maggots. And I remember I screamed and I tied it and I threw it out. Then one of my buddies downstairs thought I was getting like assaulted, so he came up with a knife. He's like, where is he? I'm like, he's in the bag. Like I was like freaking the fuck out. But I'll never forget that image of all those maggots like in there. Like it's like cemented in my head. It was so fucking gross.
Yeah, no, you know.
And on skin. On skin's way. I can't even. And how he's not reacting.
He's not
reacting. Was he on drugs? Like, I hope he was.
No.
Sober, being like I feel a fly grazes me. And I'm like, there's a fly. And I scrub that part of my arm.
Yeah.
My God.
I don't know. But, you know.
So that's your worst body story then, for sure.
It was for sure the worst thing I've ever seen on a person.
Oh, yes. My God. Okay, what was the limb one? Now I'm getting ready to this.
The limb. Oh.
The limb. What's the worst limb hanging?
I mean, there's a lot of limb stuff.
How many? Okay. Before I forget this one, how many things have you found up butts?
Oh, all the time.
All the time. Is all that the most time. Common? Because I think...
It is very common.
Okay, what's the weirdest butt thing you've heard? I've heard a hairbrush in there
before. Butts and vaginas. For some reason, girls, like, they forget things are in there.
Forget things are in there.
Either the forget things are in there or they come in. Like, well, I mean, we've had a lot of, like, young couples come in and they would have sex when the girl still had her tampon in. I'm like, did you forget or did you like it in there?
No, I think a lot of women forget the tampon. Sometimes they go up so far, like, especially those little OB ones. There's been a lot of those tales, but, like, what other things are they forgetting up there? Like toys? Coins?
I mean, one lady had like a phone charger in there for some reason.
Phone charger in her vagina.
But she was also not really there.
I was like, Apple, I think we need to get better at the batteries if this woman's just fucking like, I gotta have my charger on me at all times.
She was also not all there, but we found something like it was like a wire dangling out of, I was undressing her and I was like, I saw something. I'm like, ma'am, is that like, are you okay? But she was also like, you know, not really trying to talk to me. So
I
was like, hey guys, can you come in here and help me get this
because you
out.
Can't go in there and just start poking around.
Yeah, so we've...
pulling it out? Like long, it's like, a really long
when
one,
is this
too.
You? It's like a zit. Is it a wind-up toy?
You're like, actually, my phone's dying. You just plug it in. My God.
This is perfect.
This is perfect. Anyways, well, I'll check your vitals, but my... Oh, finally, TikTok's working again.
Finally. Say cheese selfie? Yeah.
Oh, my God. Yeah. That's crazy. Yeah. But what's in the butt?
Oh man.
A lot of guys, are the bottles. I heard a lot of bottles stuff in the butt.
A lot of bottles, a lot of vegetables, yeah, a lot vegetables. Of fruit. You know, this is not my story, but this is probably one of the crazier things. I'm doing a show, like, this is so funny. When I do shows around the country now, a lot of healthcare workers come.
Yeah.
And they cannot wait to tell me their grossest story.
I love that.
I was in New Jersey and this nurse comes up to me and was like, "You would not believe what happened to me last week." This guy comes in with a dead gerbil up his ass. And I was like, what? How? He stuck one of those like gerbil running tube things. Not running tube things. Like, you know, like in a
the
cage.
Balls?
There's like a cage.
Oh,
like
yeah, the running thing.
There's like colorful tubes.
Oh, yeah.
So he had one of those. He stuck that up his ass, put the gerbil at the end of it, lit a lighter to heat it up so the gerbil could only run one way. The gerbil ran all the way up his ass. He took the tube out and the gerbil had a seizure in his ass and it died. And that just got him off.
This man needs to go to prison. This man needs to be put in behind bars. This man's out there living his life right now. We're allowing this man to be out in society.
I guess.
This is disgusting. Richard Gere or whatever the fuck he did years ago with this gerbil thing really fucked people up.
Mm.
Richard Gere, you sick pig.
There it was.
Why did you start? I'm blaming Richard Gere. Richard Gere started Richard all of Gere. This.
Get your ass
he listens
in here.
To this podcast. I'll get Richard Gere on the podcast. Richard, I have something to ask you. The gerbil. Why? This is, okay, animal cruelty, number one.
Mm-hmm.
Number two, there's like fake gerbils now. There's fake toys that run around a little if you want the feeling. I hate this man. That's worse than the maggot thing to me for some reason. First of all, you're lighting the gerbil's little poor little butt.
Yeah.
Lighting it up there. People are sick.
It wasn't my story, but I totally believe it.
I believe it.
Yeah.
Oh, I 100% believe this. People are fucking sick in the head. Get off a different way. There's got to be, put your hand up your ass and open it up and close it a couple times. Isn't that something?
He probably did that a few times before already.
This guy's first rodeo.
Yeah,
he just went right to the gerbil in the ass?
No, there's no way.
You should, now I kind of want to work at a pet store and I'm going to watch people. I'm like, you want a gerbil? And I'll be like, let me take your vitals before we let you fucking near a gerbil. There should be a screening process. Only children should be allowed to have gerbils and hamsters. That should be it.
Yeah,
it's a little fun.
Only children are allowed to stick gerbils up their ass.
Yeah, that's what I'm trying to say. Only small little kids can put a gerbil up there. I just found this out about hamsters. I'm very upset. I used to have a hamster. Did you have a hamster growing up?
We did have a hamster.
Did you? What was your name?
I forgot. It was my sister's hamster. And she neglected the shit out of it. So
no.
Yeah.
Oh my God! So many bad animal stories.
Steph likes animals.
I love animals. Also, I had a hamster and I had three my whole life, but my sister sent me an article that apparently hamsters go into hibernation and you think they're dead and they're rock hard for like a day, but if you leave them, they come back to life. And I'm like, oh my God, I may have killed my last hamster. I had a hamster named Poopy. It lived way too long, 6 years. It was fucking huge.
Oh.
And I thought it died. And me and my friend, all I had at the time was this like little Chinese takeout box, you know, the ones that I like fold up the top. And I shoved it in the garbage can in Toronto.
He was sleeping.
I know. I killed my hamster. I killed Poopy.
Poopy was sleeping.
What the heck? Maybe, but I think maybe he woke up and he was like, oh, and then he was in the garbage and he hit garbage and then he left forever. And Poopy's still alive. Poopy walks still in the door. Alive. Hey, I got something to say to you. He's all jacked up now. He's biggest all jacked. Hamster.
He's fucking huge.
Roided
he
out,
ate
yeah.
everything in that dumpster and he's as big as us now.
He is. He ate the whole fucking city of Toronto and now he's going to come back and kill me. And then he's going to crawl my ass and be like, how do you like it, Richard? I'm like, I'm not Richard. Oh my God. Okay. These are great stories. They're a horrendous way for me to start my morning without anything to eat, but I'm loving
it. Oh yeah. Oh yeah.
So you've had no body stuff though.
Like
you've
had no, personally? Yeah. What if I stuck up my ass? Let me see.
Yeah. What if I, how many things are up my ass right now?
What if I had up there?
Excuse me.
No, I've
nothing at all. Perfect specimen. No breaks, no scratches, no rashes.
Oh, nothing really happens.
How were your parents growing up though? Were they weird with like body stuff? Did they tell anything?
Oh, you know what actually happened? When I was working, I think I was at Stanford at the time, but I had these like weird spots come up in my body. I didn't know what it was, but turns out it was like seasonal eczema.
Oh.
And so like I needed a cream. Like I didn't know that was a thing.
I didn't know there was a seasonal eczema. Maybe I have that.
Yeah, I had
I'm covered in lumps all the time.
Let's see it. Open it up.
One. That could be a zit. Actually, I don't know what that is. one whitehead? I'm sick. You also having a zit not on your face is so disgusting. An arm zit is fucking perverse. I had a finger zit. How gross is that on my pinky? What am I doing? Rubbing it on fucking kielbasa? Like, it's disgusting. So no, okay, perfect body. But you had Asian parents. Were they not like saying weird things growing up to you to like scare you into stuff? Like they have like weird remedies.
Okay, so here's one. So like I had the seasonal eczema and I was working in the ER, like, but I wasn't gonna work for like another week and I was scratching myself and my mom's like, what the hell's going on? I'm like, oh, I got this thing that popped up, I don't know what it is. And she saw it and she's like freaked the fuck out. She's like, oh my God, we gotta fix that thing. Like, what are you gonna do? I'm like, I'm just gonna wait till I go to the ER and ask one of the doctors what's going on. And she's like, No, we're like, I got something. This woman comes out of her garage with a fucking banana leaf. My mom has banana leaves in the garage.
Just in a drawer? Where are they?
They're in the garage. Well, like she uses it for cooking. Like she wraps like rice in it. She cooks it. But she brought out the banana leaf and she took a Sharpie and she wrote some Vietnamese words on it. And she hands it to me. She goes, Steven, take this banana leaf and you can go home tonight. Stand outside your house. Read the words on this banana leaf out loud and then throw the banana leaf on top of your roof.
Very specific instructions.
And the spots will go away. And I'm like, Mom, did you just give me a fucking spell? What the fuck did you just hand me?
Did you do it?
No!
What the heck?
What the fuck?
What if it works?
I was like, Mom, I'm doing this. She's like, do it. I'm like, whatever. So I take it home. I throw it away. Like,
okay.
Like,
you didn't even read it?
No, I didn't read it.
That's
I went to the doctor. It was seasonal eczema. They gave me a cream. I rubbed it on. Used the cream. It went away. And, you know, I see my mom like a week later. I'm like, you know, she's like, what happened? Are they gone? I'm like, yeah, no, they're gone. And she goes, see, I told you my spell worked. I'm like, Mom, I went to go see a doctor.
It's not you.
It's not you.
Did you ever diagnose yourself with stuff? I guess you didn't have to because you always could be like, I have this.
Yeah, I just went to work and was like,
but you're just a healthy boy. You're a healthy. Yeah. Nothing wrong with you. Can't believe this. Never an STD. Nothing.
Never an STD.
Lucky you.
Never an STD.
Must be nice. Ladies.
Risking it a lot on the road these days, but yeah.
Oh, you better be wrapping it up on the road.
Dude, I like always.
Okay. Yeah, no, I stopped. And
you know,
but you got to.
The thing with some people like I have friends who are like, did you use a condom? Like, is that even a question? Like, there are
it
some
is.
People out there who just like raw dogging it.
Oh, I've been raw dogging. Actually, now I'm just thinking about it. I'm like, should I get tested for AIDS again? I like getting tested for AIDS. It's fun for me to do. I think I will today.
I will stop a fucking moment to go get a condom. I will go look for one.
No, you. And this is how you should be.
Yeah.
Because I was getting reckless.
Oh yeah.
But now I have a boyfriend who I love so much, and I don't have AIDS.
But what is it like? What is it like? Are you? We just not interested in the condom. You're just so in the moment at the time. Like,
you know what
it
is. I'll tell you what it is. And this is not good. And I've said this before on here, and I hate saying it, but my doctor in Toronto told me that. So the main thing you're trying not to get. I mean, AIDS is the big one. You don't want HIV. That's what we were trying to do here. But herpes and HPV, it's run rampant so badly now that you can get it from the entire boxer shorts area. So you can even be wearing like little briefs. I could be wearing a thong. I could be riding you, full genitals not out, just the skin around touching, and we can still get HPV and herpes from that.
Really?
Yes. So in my head, when I'm all horned up and drunk, I'm like, what does it matter?
Getting it.
Which is so disgusting.
That is not what your doctor wants.
It's not what my doctor wants. And I'm not telling you to do this. If you're listening, wrap up your fucking dongs. It's disgusting. And then I got like female condoms as a joke. I was going to use those, but they're too much.
So, but.
But wrap it up. I'm saying wrap it up. But, it's also pregnancy scares. Because I've been, me and the BF have been real reckless. He's been shooting in there and nothing's happened yet. So maybe my eggs are dead, but.
Are you on birth control?
I'm on absolutely nothing. No.
Are you serious? This is what people come to the ER for. They come at, oh God.
No, tell me. I need to be. I'm being crazy. Because part of me, like, my sister just had a baby and she's really cute. I'm like, do I want a cute little baby now?
Part of you wants a baby.
I think so. Because I've also never like been with somebody who I love this much. Uh-huh. So I'm like, if I do want a kid, he's the only person I've ever actually wanted a kid with. I don't know. I'm being crazy. My manager's like, you're not getting pregnant now. You have too much going on. I'm like, I could be like Ellie Wong. And I was like, no, I can't. All I do is act out. So I can't be pregnant with...
I mean, here's the thing. Like, if you want to be pregnant, I'm so happy for you. I love kids. I want a baby, right?
Do you? Aww.
I do. But if you're not trying to get pregnant and you're just fucking around,
no, I need to stop. I don't want to go on birth control though because it makes me crazy, and I'm already this is me sane.
That's unfortunate. Yeah,
that's the problem.
Birth control does fuck with you.
I can also just him not come inside me. That's simply it.
Yes.
There's one.
Is it him? Is it like, can he not pull out?
No, he can. Okay. But I'm like, I want more. I'm gross. I'm so disgusting.
But even then, I don't believe in the pull out method, man. Put a fucking condom on.
It just doesn't feel good. Especially when you're with somebody, though. If you're like fucking on the road, if you're like fucking randos, then yeah.
No, dude. See, even when I had like girlfriends, like we're putting a condom
on. Oh, really?
Yeah, I'm weird about it.
No, it's good, though.
I'm weird about
it. You don't mind the feeling? It feels fine for you?
No.
I feel like I'm getting, wear a condom. If you're single,
please,
wear a condom.
If you're not trying to get pregnant, you have to.
So people are coming to ER thinking they're pregnant it was like a surprise. Do you ever have surprise pregnancies come in where they had no idea? They're like, oh.
All the fucking time. More common than the butt thing.
Really?
Young girls, not even young girls, like they just come in. They're like, I have a stomach ache. I don't know what's going on. And our very first question for a girl with abdominal pain, any chance you could be pregnant? And they will always be like, no. Like, are you sure? It's like, absolutely, right? I'm like, all right, if you're sure, let's just get a pregnancy test anyways. It always comes back positive.
And how far along are we talking with these then?
It could be, I've seen as far as like 6 months.
What?
Yeah.
Okay, at that point, no, you're missing your period. You would know, I feel everything. I have one little thing off, pH balance, a scent is off. I'm like, something's wrong, something's going on down there. I have one ingrown hair, I'm like, I'm down there with a mirror being like, what is that?
Something's happening.
Like,
no, like I don't know what it is. And I think, like, and I don't know, this is not science, but like girls have you guys have a different pain tolerance just because, you know, you're going through periods every month.
Yes.
Your pain tolerance is much higher. Yes. You feel things where you're just like, that's just a monthly thing. You don't know what it is. I agree, though. Like, missing a period is a big thing. But, like, they just don't think about it. And these girls who don't know that they're pregnant, you can't see it because they're also a little on the heavier side.
Oh, okay.
So you can't tell.
Okay.
So girls will come in, like, they're like... 5-6 months pregnant, and we're like, you're definitely pregnant. And they're so confused, they break down, they cry.
And because at that point it's too late for an abortion. Yeah,
it's a little too late.
Yeah, it's a little too late.
Yeah.
My God, ladies, what are we doing out there?
It happens all the time, Steph, I'm telling you, all the time.
That's the most common thing that comes in?
It's very common. Like, are you pregnant? No. Any chance you could be pregnant? No. Using birth control? Yeah. Okay, you're pregnant. What type of birth control? He pulls out. I'm like, get the fuck out of my...
No, I wouldn't say I'm using birth control. Yeah. I'm saying I'm definitely not using birth control. My God.
Maybe I'll get all the time.
No, I'm not going to do any of these
all
things.
The time.
What else is like a really common one that comes in? My heart attack? Is that like...
For the most part in the ER, it's a lot of old people.
Okay.
It's a lot of old people who, you know, they have... shortness of breath or their chest hurts a little, because at that point they're very fragile and like the family members are like, okay, well, anything's wrong with you, I'm worried, let's just get you to the ER to make sure. So we deal with a lot of old people.
Okay.
It's a lot of old people.
What's the funniest one that's come in? One that's like the
funniest old person
or the funniest like the ailment that's come in where you're like, this is crazy, but it's like kind of funny, like any like weird dick ones? I don't know why I'm so obsessed with penis. Like any like hanging off, any like dangling dicks or like any bad sex accidents?
Oh man, all the time.
All the time?
Yeah, all the time.
Like any broken penises?
Yeah, there was actually a really high profile guy, and I can't say who it was, but it was in the Bay Area. He was involved with the sports team.
Oh.
And he hired a couple dancers back to his room.
Uh-huh. You know,
and broke his dick.
Broke his dick.
Broke his dick.
In half.
Broke his
so
dick.
So what?
Yeah.
What do you? How do you fix a broken dick?
I have no fucking idea.
Because is it like? It's. I don't get what it's. I don't get what's in there.
I'm not sure either. It's like blood and muscle. I don't know what it is. The thing with the ER is we rarely follow up because the ER, we get you stable
and we get
you upstairs and they fix it.
Yeah, also, it'd be weird if you're like, me again? What happened to your pee-pee? Like, that's, if my ER nurse followed
I'm
me up, I'd be
back.
Like, this is
good.
Yeah. Remember me? How's the Maggots?
I found your phone on the chart. Just wanted to check in on the penis.
Yeah, like, why the fuck? Yeah, that's so creepy. No, that would be bizarre. But like, no one talks. There's not like a bunch, you guys aren't by the water cooler.
Sometimes we'll call back. Sometimes we'll call upstairs to the OR and be like, hey, how did that surgery turn out?
Yeah.
And they'll tell us.
Okay.
Like, he made it or he didn't.
Oh, God.
Because, like, we're invested in, like, the guy that we help stabilize. You know, we care about him.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Did he make it? Yes, he did. No, he didn't. But that's as far as that goes. We're not calling upstairs and be like, hey, how's the penis? Did you fix it?
You fix it? I want to read. Oh, my God. Okay, I have somebody. I have people send in some stories.
Oh, yeah.
I got a story, an eyeball story, and I don't love eyeball stories. I tell people not to send me these, but no one fucking listens to me and they keep doing it. Now, of course, I can't fucking find this goddamn. Here it is.
An eyeball story.
Quick eye story. Okay, so this is from Kelsey. Just quick eye story, all lowercase, so I'm scared coming into this. Hi, Steph. I've got a good, gross eye story for your podcast. I was clipping my 4-year-old son's toenails, and one of the clippings flicked up into my eyeball and got stuck in there deep under the eyelid. It was sharp and big, and I had to dig around for a while to retrieve it. My son didn't have a lot of sympathy for me. All okay now. Happy holidays. I thought there was going to be more to that story. No ER for her, I guess. That's gross. Have you ever had you've had eye stuff come in. What's the worst? I don't want to ask this, but I'm like, what's the worst eye thing that's happened? That's crazy, though. That's disgusting. Her son's fucking toenail went into her eyeball. And then it was like scraped around there, I guess, for a while. And she had to dig it out.
Ooh.
That's gross. That I feel like you get infected from that, wouldn't you?
Yeah.
Toenail from a toe, obviously.
Yeah.
A foot. A kid's foot, too, is gross. They're mucking around. They're not wearing socks. They're outside.
There's all kinds of like gross bacteria on that toenail.
Ew.
It's a kid.
Are you OCD now because you're like around germs so much?
No, actually, it's the other way around. It's worse. I don't give a shit. Because I've been around, when you work in the ER, I'm surrounded by all kinds of random stuff. And like, this is not going to, like, I haven't gotten sick. So I'm just like, I'm a little bit more cavalier with people when people are sick, you know, like even during COVID, right?
You working ER during COVID?
Yeah.
Fuck.
I was in ER during COVID. In the beginning, it was like, okay, gown up, get that astronaut suit on. You're not going in there. He has COVID.
Yeah.
You know.
You never got COVID?
I got caught up with COVID. Okay. I did. But I wasn't working at the ER.
Oh, fuck.
I got it after.
Oh,
isn't
shit.
That crazy?
That's wild.
That's crazy. I got it when I was in New York, just hanging out.
Oh my God.
I know, I was pissed.
Fuck.
I was pissed.
That whole time in there.
But my point is like in the ER, eventually what it was like, because here's the thing too, when the patient's in the room and an emergency happens, like to put all that stuff on takes time, right?
Yeah.
So now it's like get a mask on, get some gloves on, just get in there, make sure they're okay. So like it got to the point where I'm just like, it's all right, it's whatever.
Yeah, you're just going in there.
I'm not gonna put on a fucking protection.
Oh my God. So wait, eyeball stuff. Have you had I want to know why I'm asking this. I'm gonna be sick. The mega thing's already bad enough.
I can't remember an eyeball thing. Like people get stuff in their eye all the time. Like I remember one guy, like he was really upset because like he was messing around with this plant. So I got like sap in his eye.
Ooh,
that was bad.
Sap's bad. So sap's sticky. Bad. How do you get it out? Rinse it?
Yeah, we have to wash it. Yes, we'd like
hold
keep,
it open.
Keep his eye open and just fucking
with what? What do you want?
Saline. Saline.
Oh God! No, you know
you
what?
Pretty much just gotta rinse it until it's all gone.
Why would I ask the eye thing? Okay, we'll get to the final question here of the podcast, which you didn't know the questions because it's fine.
This is fine. Someone messed up. We won't say who.
We can improvise here. What do you think's the funniest way you can die? Like you personally.
the funniest way I can die?
Mm-hmm. You just say gerbil in your ass. Two gerbils, two tubes, one ass.
I really hope it's not something stupid, like I trip and fall and hit my head on a rock or something. That would probably be the worst way to die.
Yeah, yeah, just something not even funny or fun.
Just something like super random. You know, you see stuff falling off buildings all the time. I hope it's like someone just didn't actually knock their cup off a balcony of like 20 feet and I'm walking to get like a lunch.
And it's not even like a big cup, it's like an empty coffee cup or something.
And I just fucking die.
That would be horrendous.
That'd be the worst way to die.
That would be the worst way to die. Well, thank you so much for coming on here and sharing all these wild stories.
Oh, yeah.
Please, where can everybody find your tickets and find you online and stuff?
I am at Stevio, Steveioe. And my tickets are at stephenhocomedy.com.
There we go. Simple stuff. Go see him on the road.
Yeah.
Follow him on TikTok. Follow him on Instagram. And your podcast. Pump your podcast.
I do have a podcast. It's called the Badass Motherfucker Podcast, where we nominate... we highlight great healthcare workers from around the country, mm-hmm. nominated by their coworkers. So you have to be nominated by your coworker. And we'll have you on. We'll highlight you, give you $1,000 as a little bonus for being a great healthcare worker, because you guys deserve it.
Yeah.
And
And you do. Look at this. And I don't pay my guests fucking anything. Thank you so much for listening. Thanks for joining me. Keep following along, Steph Infection. Watch my YouTube and subscribe, please. It helps. Bye.
Bye.